tonight on Raw.
Part of the WWE app during the commercial break. A lot of activity going on at the WWE app right now, live on the WWE app. The WWE app, the new way to watch TV.
Roto better app, somebody.
And anyone who has downloaded the WWE app,
you've got to download the WWE app. Earlier tonight on the WWE app, vote on the app a little bit later on tonight. If you're watching on the WWE app,
for those of you who have downloaded the app,
turning out in droves. Record numbers already on the WWE app. We're turning out in droves, voting tonight on the WWE app.
Absolutely
on the WWE app. Just on the WWE app.
If you downloaded the WWE app and
we voted in record numbers on the WWE app tonight.
And if you were on the app, you got to listen to it. One of the,
if you've downloaded the app,
that's like a big fucking cock right in your face. Just, All right, Monday Night Raw for 5/27/2013, May 27th. And it's Memorial Day Raw. and Cena's back. Cena's back, baby. Woo! I'm so happy! Okay, but the Memorial Day tribute at the beginning of the show was nice. WWE Raw always puts on a good tribute. And I'm feeling a little out of it today. I had a hell of a day at work. I'm super tired, and I'm in a different location. My current location is not optimal at the moment, so it's gonna be probably a little goofy today. But we're gonna get through it. So speaking of goofy, the show opens with John Cena coming out. Oh boy. And before we even get to this, let me talk about last week on Raw. John Cena wasn't on the show. And I saw a lot of reviews last week with people talking about how great it was that the WWE kept John Cena off the show, that it was, you know, a good way to do the story, and they applauded that. And I didn't talk about it at all on my review last week. And you know, I thought about it, and I thought it was good, and I wanted to say, you know, congratulations, WWE, but the more I thought about it, the more I thought, no, I'm not going to congratulate them for that. You know why? Because that's the basics. That's booking 101, you know. You're trying to sell somebody taking a fucking ridiculous bump, you know, nearly life-threatening bump the night before. Of course you're going to keep them off TV the next night. Hell, you keep them off TV for like 2 or 3 weeks. But, you know, most of the time in the WWE, John Cena, you could put him through a fucking concrete wall onto a sticks of dynamite and blow his ass up, and he'll still come out the next night on Raw, hunky-dory, happy-tappy, hoofy-goofy, retarded moron. Sorry for retard. I don't like to use that. I try not to. But, you know, I'm not going to congratulate them for doing the basics. They should be doing the basics all the time. They're not going to get a fucking applause from me. I don't think so. No. You know, do that shit all the time. When John Cena, you're supposed to sell an injury, keep him off TV. Remember last year at Extreme Rules when Brock Lesnar beat the fuck out of him? And he still won the match, but then after the match, Cena got on the mic and said, even though I won and I got the shit beat out of me, you know, because I got beat up so bad, I'm going to take a little break. Guess what? 24 hours later, he was back on Raw. So this one time, they got the basics right. No applause from me. You know, you're supposed to do the basics all the time, WWE. You fucking idiots. So John Cena comes out, and people boo the shit out of him. This guy can't walk into an arena on the world, on the ground of the earth, and have people not boo the shit out of him. It just doesn't happen anymore. It doesn't. And then he gets on the mic and he says this again. Seems like there's a lot of unrest in the air tonight. Really? You think? Let's think back 2 weeks ago. I'm not talking a huge stretch of time. I'm talking 14 days ago. He said the exact same thing when he stepped into the middle of the ring and the music cut out and people booed the fuck out of him then. How many times does this guy gotta try to shrug off the boos? They're not They're not booing whatever angle you're trying to sell, Cena. They're booing you. You suck. They hate you. But he comes out, and he's just, like, slapping you in the face with his dick every single time. And I'm getting tired of getting hit with John Cena's cock. I really am. I don't like the way it feels. It doesn't feel very good at all. So Cena's promo basically... Oh, here's something nice. Cena says he should be the champ, and people boo him. Per usual. And then they say... And then Cena says that Ryback thinks he should be the champ. And it was so dead silent after that, I thought I heard somebody in the crowd fart. You know, no, there was no reaction. Again, nobody cares about Ryback. People should care about him, but the WWE ruined his character. They turned him heel way too soon, and now he runs away, and he... It, given his size and his power, this doesn't make sense that he's a pussy. It never makes sense to make heels pussies, but this guy in particular really doesn't make sense. It's just such a hard contrast between his look and his character and how he acts now versus how he used to. It's fucking ridiculous. Then Cena does more shitty jokes, and it was awful. You know, he's trying to make fun of Ryback, and he sounded like an absolute fucking idiot. And then he announces that he wants to do a Three Stages of Hell match. Which, I believe that's supposed to be like a hardcore match. It wasn't. The stipulations are not hardcore. Lumberjack match, stage one. Stage two tables match. If it goes to a third, which everybody knows it's going to go to a third match, it's going to be an ambulance match. None of those are hardcore. The ambulance match is mock hardcore. It's fucking ridiculous. So, when they announced this, I thought, man, there's nobody anywhere interested in this feud. So they got to throw as much gimmick stipulations into one fucking match as they possibly can to try to get people to pay attention to what's going on. It's a cry for attention for this feud. Because nobody's interested. Nobody cares. And you know what? It seems like they're setting it up for another... They're either going to completely bury Ryback, or it's going to be another goofy fucking ending. That's what it's going to be. Those are your two options here. Because again, just like I've said before, Cena is not going to lose. There's no way that ending's never going to change. You know, Cena will keep the championship. And then Ryback comes out, and his promo was not very good. It just wasn't. The things he was saying didn't make sense for his character to say them. It wasn't very good. But he accepted the challenge, of course. So now you got a Three Stages of Hell match coming up at the next pay-per-view. It's such a loaded gimmick match to try to get people to pay attention. But guess what? Still nobody's gonna care. So then immediately with Cena still in the ring, Heyman comes out. With Curtis Axel. Heyman calls to have John Cena versus Curtis Axel because Axel just beat Triple H last week via countout. And now he wants to beat Cena this week. And Cena accepts. And let me tell you something. That is a huge push for this new gimmick. He's not a new guy. I don't want to call him a new guy because Henning's been around for a while. But this new gimmick... 2 weeks in a row, the first week against Triple H, the next week against Cena, both in the main event. I mean, that's rare that guys get a push like that in this day and age. Very rare. So I was surprised that they did that. So next up was Big E Langston versus Alberto Del Rio because Ziggler is still out with a concussion. Boy, I miss Ziggler. But Big E did a good job, and Alberto... these two kind of work well together, I'm noticing. So, it was decent. There was a nice suicide dive by Del Rio to the outside. What ends up happening is AJ takes the padding off of one of the turnbuckles. But Big E winds up getting hit. They're taking the turnbuckle shot instead of Del Rio, and he gets pinned because of that. And then AJ is bitching at Biggie Langston after the match, and she walks out on him. Or he walks out on her, I don't remember. The match was pretty decent. It was fast-paced. You know, it had to be, because I think it was only like 5 minutes long. So, but in that 5 minutes, they did a lot. I mean, it was pretty decent. So not too bad. Next up was a backstage promo between Kane and Daniel Bryan, where Bryan still thinks that he's the weak link. And then Bret Hart showed up and said that Daniel Bryan is one of the best and toughest wrestlers of all time. And I couldn't really get behind this promo. You could just tell that everybody was reading from a script. And it just all felt very, very forced. There was no authenticity to it at all. But the goal was to make Daniel Bryan, you know, get a rub from Bret Hart, you know, talking him up. And that was mission accomplished, at least. So I like that. Next up was a match, Dean Ambrose versus Kofi Kingston, U.S. title rematch. This match had a very cool start to it. It was very, very fast-paced at the beginning, and there was lots of good sequences off the ropes between the two guys. Lots of back and forths. It was very nice. A lot of energy there at the beginning. Very cool. And then, at one point, Ambrose trips Kofi off of the apron. Ambrose is on the mat, and Kofi's on the apron. He trips his leg out from under him. Kofi takes a header, fucking face first, right into the steel steps. And then from that point on, Kofi was just out, and Ambrose just rolled him inside the ring. It was all Ambrose, man. Just picked him up and hit him with that cool DDT-like finisher and got the clean victory on Kofi Kingston. So it was a cool finish to the match. But next up was the best match of the night, in my opinion, was Kane and Daniel Bryan versus Seth Rollins and Roman Reigns for a tag team title rematch. And this match was long. It was very long. It was a fun match. It was awesome. I mean, I have nothing but good things to say about this match. A couple of spots I wrote down. There was a nice double team move by Kane and Daniel Bryan early on. I believe Kane had him up and had one of the guys up. It was Rollins in a bear hug, or he had just hit an atomic drop. And then Daniel Bryan bounced off the ropes and hit him with a clothesline, I believe, while Kane was holding him. That was cool. And then Seth Rollins hit Kane with a jumping sort of spin kick at one point. And that was very nice to see. It looked really cool. You know, it was just your basic move, but it just had a lot of momentum behind it. It was very well executed. At one point, Daniel Bryan got the hot tag. And the man tore that ring up. He did an amazing running drop kick to Reigns, who was on the apron, and Reigns was set flying out of the fucking... He was just set flying out of camera into the guardrail. Then Daniel Bryan destroyed Rollins with this huge German suplex. I almost wonder if he didn't come close to botching that, because he just went so fast and... And Seth Rollins almost fucking landed right on the top of his head, and that could have been brutal. So, but as it was, it looked fucking awesome. I mean, it looked devastating, but it almost looked like he could have legitimately got hurt. A big super backdrop at one point as well. That was very cool. And at one point, there was a "This is awesome" chant came up during the match. And you know what? I got to agree. I thought the wrestling in the match was pretty fucking awesome. Absolutely. And Daniel Bryan was fucking awesome in this match. Daniel Bryan, last week and this week, has been on his game. And he can be like that all the time. And it's just nice to see a little bit of that shining through this goofy, stupid-ass gimmick that he's got. We're getting more of the more serious wrestler Daniel Bryan lately, and I like that. But in the end, the Shield wound up winning the match, and... yeah, it was a great match, and it was a highlight of the show, and I definitely recommend, if you're going to check out any part of Raw, that's the match you want to watch, and the Ambrose-Kofi match, you know. I like that the Shield, that they're breaking them up into separate matches now, because it just stretches out the amount of good quality on the show. So I approve of that. Next up was Michael Cole. And talking about Triple H's injury, the head trauma, whatever it was. I don't know. You know, Ziggler has a real concussion. And it's barely gotten any time. They're trying to push it, keep your attention off of it because it's a legit injury. But Triple H's fake concussion or fake head injury, I don't know if they really called it a concussion. This one's getting more attention. It's fake, you know. I don't know how I feel about that, you know. I don't really care for it. Because Ziggler's got a legit injury, but Triple H's fake one is getting all this attention. And then they're like, oh, Triple H is... He doesn't need any further medical treatment. He's going to be back in action Wednesday or Thursday or something. Meanwhile, Dolph Ziggler's been out with a legit concussion for like 3 or 4 fucking weeks. So, whatever. I don't care for it. Next up was Wade Barrett versus Fandango, with The Miz voted to be the special guest referee. Wade Barrett tossed Miz... At one point during the match, he just threw him into the mat, so Miz hit skull-crushing finale on Barrett, and then Fandango pinned him after that, and then The Miz also attacked Fandango after the match. I'm pretty sure that Fandango's entrance was longer than the match itself. Alright, so next up was the three-man band versus Tons of Fucking Shit and the Great Khali. Well, I'm not wasting my time on that. Next up was the highlight reel with Chris Jericho, and Paul Heyman was the guest. This was a good promo between these two. I liked it. I didn't know where it was going at first, and then it was, you know, they wanted to talk about CM Punk, which, that's cool with me, you know. I wasn't expecting that, but eventually they got around to having... another CM Punk versus Chris Jericho match announced for the next pay-per-view. And I'll gladly take that, because so far every single match that those two have had has been fucking spectacular. So if you want to give me another one, I will gladly take another one. CM Punk's on his way back, and I could not be happier. Absolutely, I absolutely cannot wait. After that was Divas match, Bellas versus Caitlyn and Natalya. Yeah, that's not happening either. So after that was a quick backstage promo between Bret Hart and Kurt Axel. And it wasn't very long, but I think that Axel came off very strong and confident in that promo. You know, it doesn't happen a lot with heels in the WWE because they make him into fucking pussies nowadays. Axel, at one point, you know, he didn't have a lot of lines. At one point, he said, you know, you go enjoy your appreciation night. I'm going to go beat the WWE champ. That's cool. That makes him sound confident. A lot of their heels are lacking that. A lot of their heels are fucking pussies. Because the WWE has to chicken shit them for some goofy-ass reason that I will never understand. Actually, I do kind of have a theory about what that reason is, but that's probably... a rant for a different time. Next up is Orton and Sheamus versus the Rhodes Scholars. And I always talk about how I'm up and down with Randy Orton. Sometimes I think he's awesome in the ring, and sometimes I am bored with his matches. And this is one of the times where I was fucking bored. I could not get into this match. I tried. I really wanted to stay interested in this match, but... It started out really slow, and then by the time it picked up, I couldn't get into it. And nothing really that interesting happened. I mean, they were all wrestling decent. The wrestling wasn't bad, but it wasn't very interesting. Because I knew that the Rhodes Scholars were going to lose, and then at the end, nothing was going to happen, and that's exactly what went down. So I just didn't really care about it. I don't know if... Anyway, I don't know if you guys felt any differently about it, but for me, match did not do it for me. Next up was the main event. John Cena versus Curtis Axel. Cena's back in the main event. I bet you're all excited. I know I was fucking ecstatic. I couldn't wait. And the main thing I want to talk about, and it's a shame that this is the main thing that I want to talk about, is at one point during the match, the match just comes to like a grinding halt. It comes to a dead stop. Axel puts Cena in some sort of submission hold. And the hold seemed like to go on, seemed like it was going on forever. It only was a couple of minutes, but it seemed forever. The match just stopped. And you could see in the background, everybody in the crowd was turning, you know, to see something was going on to the right of the entrance ramp. I don't know what was happening. I didn't have time to check any news sites today to see if anybody, you know, if there was any article about what was going on over there. But I don't know what the fuck was happening, but the camera zoomed in on Axel and Cena so tight that I could see their fucking nose hairs, you know, I could see the boogers in their noses. And they just and not only that, but the cameraman shifted so that the entrance ramp was behind the camera. And you were seeing the ring from that angle. So that you could absolutely not see what was happening over by the entrance ramp. So I don't know what was going on, but the match basically stopped. But anyway, besides that, everything before that super rest hold, Curtis Axel wasn't really doing a whole lot. You know, it's weird, because I've seen Henning wrestle in the company before. He's a good wrestler. I don't really understand why they don't let him do more, because he can do more. But after the rest hold, the match picked up a little bit, and he did start to do some actual wrestling moves. Let's see here. The big things I caught that I was surprised by was that they let Axel counter the fireman's carry. I couldn't believe it. He fucking countered the fireman's carry. I was thinking, wow. And then he went and countered the STF. Well, Cena looks like a fucking retard when he's trying to do that. Again, sorry for retard. And then Axel countered the fireman's carry again. I couldn't believe it. I was surprised. This is a guy who, last time I saw him on Raw, he was a jobber, you know? Even though I think he was a tag team champion the last time I saw him, I still considered him to be a jobber. And now he's countering the fireman's carry and the STF. So that's pretty cool. And then he hit the perfect plex. It was so cool to see somebody with the last name of Henning hit the perfect plex. Oh, that was great to see. It brought back a lot of memories. It was pretty cool. And then John Cena kicked out. Of course John Cena is going to kick out, because he's John Cena. Come on now, you knew that was coming. What a fucking piece of shit. Anyway, ambulance comes a-blazing into the arena, and Cena goes to check it out, because it's got to be Ryback. It's got to be Ryback. And he gets counted out because of it. And then Ryback does eventually come from the entrance ramp, not from the ambulance, attacks Cena. But guess what? You can't keep a Super Cena down. He just, because that's what he is. He kicks it into Super Cena gear. Fuck it. And then he just overcomes Ryback, and Ryback has to run away. What a bunch of fucking shit. What a bunch of fucking garbage. So, and then at the end of the show, they announce that Axel wins the match, and they play his music. And the show ends with Axel celebrating. That's how the show closes. So at least they announced it and played his music at the end of this episode, unlike last week where they just ended with Triple H, you know, couldn't get up under the weight of his own ego. So Axel has two count-out victories, one over Triple H and one over John Cena. I guess that's the best that we can hope for from the WWE at this point, and that's a fucking shame. But this Curtis Axel push, it just seems like an afterthought. It just seems like they're attaching him to whatever other big angle is happening right now. Triple H's injury, he's an afterthought on that. John Cena Ryback, he's an afterthought on that. You know, is that really what you're going for with this guy? Can't you put him in a legit match and give him a legit victory? I mean, what's so fucking hard about that? You know, it's WWE not being able to create new stars because they are just wandering through the woods. They've lost their way when it comes to booking new talent. So too much John Cena cock is all I can imagine. They're just too busy gagging on that John Cena cock. So I don't really like the way they're doing it, but Axel's at least getting a push. I just feel like it's going to come back to bite him in the ass, or it's just going to lead to nowhere. One of the two is going to happen. And then when that happens, I'm going to fucking lose my shit. Let's talk about Raw overall. I actually didn't think it was that bad. There were several matches where I enjoyed watching what WWE was presenting to me. You know, and there's not many Raws that I can say that for. So, yeah, there were some parts that I fucking hated, but there were more that were overall, you know, not that bad a show. So, the best parts were, again, the Shield, everything involving the Shield, especially the tag match, and the highlight reel was also pretty good.